I'd like to talk to you a little bit about treatment. And immediately after somebody's bitten, I guess the first thing you'd advise is for them to panic and maybe scream.
That's what I'd probably do, but of course, the way we teach and the best thing to do is to not panic. Easy to say in a lecture, easy to read in a book, but people are going to be freaking out. Once you gather yourself, lay low, don't panic, and those around you, let them do the work of going for help. The best thing you can do is remain calm, take a deep breath. As we discussed before, it may be a dry bite and you're not even envenomated or poisoned. That's the best advice I could get.
So what about all the stuff that we read about in first aid books, cutting, sucking, etc.?
Well, those are all dramatic. Again, I love them in movies. I've done them myself, self-inflicted snake bites. But the best thing to do, first let's talk about cutting and sucking. Again, dramatic, you've seen it, where they take out their buck knife, they'll cut through the fang mark, and then just start sucking the gajibbers out of the person's arm or leg or name a body part. Don't do it. The human mouth has bacteria, flora, nastiness. That's even worse than the snake's mouth. So you're going to infect the wound by sucking on it. And worse yet, your knife, although you mean well, is going to cut through valuable structures like tendons, nerves, arteries, veins. You need those. So people who cut then suck are actually doing more harm than good. Don't do it.
People have probably heard that cold might be helpful. How do you feel about cold?
We used to feel that cold, usually it's also called cryotherapy, applying cold or ice to the wound would help. And in some bites, like bee stings, some spider bites, a little ice isn't such a bad thing. Snake bites, we discourage it. And we've even seen people trying to immerse an entire arm in an ice bath. Don't do it. It's actually going to cause more damage than good. Best thing to do is just to elevate the arm above the level of the heart. Push some oral fluids, because that's probably all you're going to have in the wilderness. You're not going to have IV fluids. Remain calm. Send someone else to get help. The best thing you can have are car keys and a cell phone.
And if, so the treatment is anti-venom?
It is, and it's getting to a facility that has it. There have been some folks saying, why don't we have anti-venom in the wilderness with paramedics ready to go? Anti-venom also has risks when you administer it. It's taken from horses, it's taken from sheep, so when you give that to humans, you may have an allergic reaction. So it's best to give the anti-venom in the hospital setting. So in the wilderness, the best thing you can do, start up a car, make a cell phone call, 911, get to a hospital facility.
So what's the deal with Crofab and why is it better than the old stuff?
I love Crofab. I think they've done a good job. They have taken the anti-venom and refined it to a much more pure type of anti-venom, so there's not as much of a chance of an allergic reaction as with the old anti-venom. It is more costly.
It's
a problem.
It's like $20 or $30 per dose.
Times that by 10.
Exactly.
So it's about $300-$400 a vial. It's expensive, so you don't want to give it out willy-nilly. I know that's not much of a medical term, but don't give it out willy-nilly. But you don't want to give it out just for every snake bite. You want to make sure there's actual evidence of envenomation, swelling of the arm, blistering, systemic or total body effects, blood toxicity, lab abnormalities that reflect a systemic or total body envenomation or poisoning. That's when you give the anti-venom. Less chance of allergic reaction with the new Crofab. It is more expensive, and we're finding it's safer in kids. And what's interesting about children is the snake is confused by the size of the human. Whether it's a toddler or an adult like yourself, the snake's going to inject the same amount of venom. So kids need the same amount of anti-venom as adults.
You're essentially treating the venom, not the patient in that way.
Exactly. We always say treat the patient, not the poison. Treat the patient, not the numbers. Here, you're treating the poison. The snake is going to inject the same amount of venom into little Johnny as it does into Grandpa Rex. So because of that, you're going to treat the patient, whether a toddler or a full-size adult, with the same amount of anti-venom.
When you're in the emergency department, and a patient's been bitten, you're not sure yet if they've been envenomated, do you wait an hour? Do you wait 2 days? At what point can you decide that the patient's probably good to go home?
Most bites, you can see something within about 6 hours. 4 to 6 hours, you're going to start seeing swelling in the arm, the leg, depending on where they were bitten, the glands. You look for swelling. Most pit vipers, rattlesnakes, cottonmouths, water moccasins, you're going to see that pretty rapidly, particularly if there's maybe a vein or an artery involved in the envenomation. So if you watch them six, maybe even stretch it to 12, and you see no swelling, labs look good, no abnormalities, you can safely send them home and reassure the patient. The exceptions are Mojave rattlesnakes. They not only have a little blood toxicity, they have a neuro or brain central nervous system toxicity. There may be a delay. I would observe them for 24s. Same with coral snakes. We don't get that many, certainly in the east, in Florida, into Texas. Here, where we are, Arizona, New Mexico, this type of coral snake is really docile. It's shy. You have to pick it up. Let it chew on your finger for about an hour. Then you may get envenomated. If you have those envenomations, you probably want to watch them for 24 hours. Otherwise, you can watch these patients in the ER. If you're going to see it, it'll manifest itself pretty quickly.
In some books, they talk about lymphatic or venous constrictors. What's your feeling about any kind of constriction?
Okay, the other word for constriction is using tourniquets, or taking a bandana and wrap tight knot around the arm or leg that's been bitten. There's really no role for that, particularly in the U.S. with pit vipers, mostly because we have hospitals, ERs, clinics that are pretty close, good paramedic system. So I would advise against it. Now, if you're way in the wilderness and you're a day or two out, you may want to do the 127-hour risk the limb to save the life, but that is really uncommon. You're probably not going to need to do a tourniquet. Now, internationally, where we have neurotoxic snakes like cobras, crates, you can loosely put them on, even rotate them to stop or impede lymphatic drainage that spreads the neurotoxin. But Australians, people from India, Africa, they're very good at that. Leave it to them. In the U.S., I'd shy away from tourniquets, avoid it, and if you do put it on loosely.
So when we say tourniquet, we're not talking about the tourniquet that most people imagine, which is an arterial tourniquet.
Correct. So it's more of a superficial tourniquet. And in the wilderness, it's probably going to be like a rag, a bandana, something like that. Maybe the tubing from your camelback or water receptacle would be a good tourniquet, but you're not going to need to use those. And in theory, they say if it's too tight, when you release it, you'll get this bolus or injection of venom. Not true, but probably what you're going to do is cause more limb, arm, leg constriction and bad healing, and that you don't want to do.
I know that in Australia, people are using ACE wraps just for gentle lymphatic compression. What's the deal with elastic compression, as in something like an ACE wrap?
I think that's fine, as long as it's not, again, too tight, too taut. There's nothing wrong with that, particularly if you're out and a bit away from your closest ER, clinic, hospital that's going to be able to see you. I don't see a problem with that. And certainly if there's any other trauma, bleeding, that can kind of help with that. And it gives the patient a feeling that you're doing something. And the people that are around the patient, they may feel like they're doing something. But again, calm, oral fluids, call 911, or just calmly drive them to the closest ER is the best thing you can do.
There are some commercial devices. One in particular is the Sawyer extractor.
Right.
What's your feeling about the extractor?
Well, there are extractors. The one that is most common is Sawyer. It's still talked about even in Boy Scout manuals. And the idea is as soon as the snake strikes, you're going to take a little suction device, kind of cause a hickey, and pull back on a syringe and pull out some of the venom. And in original studies, they thought we may get out maybe a quarter to a third of the venom and it may help. But what we're finding now, particularly with good animal studies, that it doesn't help. In fact, it may cause a little more damage in the local area. I know the Sawyer people, they're outstanding folks. I wouldn't recommend it. However, a plug for Sawyer, they do a lot with water purification internationally, and I think they're a fabulous product with their water treatment devices. So I don't want to diss the Sawyer family, but the suction devices, for the most part, even though they're still advertised, still in wilderness kits, still in emergency kits, are probably not going to help.
Is it hard to explain the hickey when you get home?
It is, particularly if you were struck on the neck by the snake.
Tim, I know that you work at a big center where you see everything. And I know part of your practice includes treating exotic snake bites.
Right.
What's your feeling about people having exotic snakes as pets?
I'm against it. I think it's a machismo thing. I understand why people want it. Leave them be, particularly exotic snakes. To get them in, they have to be flown in or shipped in internationally. You're taking them out of their habitat. It's the wrong thing to do. And then you're not being very humane putting them in a confined area. You're only going to get into trouble. And when people get bit by exotic snakes in the U.S., no one knows really how to treat them. And other than zoos, you're not going to have the proper anti-venom. It's very dangerous. It's the wrong thing to do. Don't do it.